this segment brought to you by Kansas Wheat. Learn more at rediscoverwheat.org.
I'm Brityne Rucker, and this is Ag AM in Kansas. I am at the 2020 Corn-Fed Ethanol Seminar, and with me now I have Candice Wilson on the U.S. Grain Council, Manager of Ethanol Trade Policy. Now, Candice, you talked about how ethanol is the growing fastest commodity.
Yeah, so our chief economist, Mike Dwyer, and myself conducted an analysis to analyze of all of the commodities that USDA tracks from an export standpoint, which was the fastest, and that we found on both a 5- and 10-year scale, ethanol was the fastest growing commodity and kind of had really the most potential to grow in regards to the other products.
And actually, ethanol is the cheapest source of octane over the last decade.
Yeah, so when you're looking from a perspective of how a country can kind of oxygenate its fuel and meet requirements in that regard, ethanol is the cheapest typically on a gallon for gallon standpoint as well as a point for point standpoint. So we definitely think that we have a solid message in regards to why they should be blending ethanol into their fuel supply.
And bioethanol actually not only improves air quality but also greenhouse gas emissions.
Yeah, so going back to its high octane rating, mm-hmm. when you have a higher octane rating, it means that your fuel is combusting more cleanly, and as a result of that you typically see improved air quality in countries that are blending ethanol. If you look at a picture, for instance, from Beijing or from New Delhi, countries that don't have E10 in their fuel supply, the air quality is typically pretty poor. And that's right. Something that we think that we have a strong selling message when we go to those countries in order for them to improve their air quality, reduce cancer-related deaths from that air quality. Right. And in regards to your comment about emissions, mm-hmm. the USDA conducted a study that found that U.S. ethanol is 39% less greenhouse gas intensive than gasoline. So as countries are looking to kind of reduce their greenhouse gas emissions and footprint and meet their Paris commitments, we think that ethanol has an opportunity to help them do that.
And I'm sure with your studies from other countries and even in the U.S., there's some dispelling myths about ethanol.
Absolutely. So I think if you look at the experience of implementing the renewable fuel standard here in the United States, there were a lot of, you know, questions or concerns that were perpetrated by people unfamiliar with ethanol or the oil industry. One of those, and probably the most famous everyone has heard of, is food versus fuel, right? So you're taking food that is meant for a human and instead you're burning it in a vehicle. Right. We know that's simply not the case. With the yield advancements that we've seen in global coarse grains production, ethanol only accounts for about 5% of total production mm-hmm. of, you know, corn, sorghum, etc. The rest goes to feeding animals or to feeding humans. And so when we talk about this messaging overseas, we want people to understand that it's not food versus fuel, it's food and fuel.
Now, you've done some case studies in different countries involving ethanol.
Yes, that's correct.
Now, can you go into those in those specific countries?
Well, I think that one that's kind of been a really big success story for our industry has been Japan. Mm-hmm. The U.S. Grains Council had a very prominent effort there working with our stakeholders with the Foreign Ag Service of USDA, growth in RFA, and the corn states that have helped provide funding there. We've able to obtain 44% market share of the ethanol that goes into ETBE production, mm-hmm. which is about 91 million gallons of ethanol. Moving forward, we hope to increase that even more by getting them to blend E10 eventually. And we just want to see increased global ethanol demand.
So going right into that, where do we go from here as an industry involving ethanol?
Well, I think from the international standpoint, we're really wanting to get over that 7 to 10% threshold of ethanol that's exported every year. You know, we see huge potential in countries like China and Indonesia, and even in Brazil, which is currently our largest customer. And we think that if we can build a strong coalition of countries that support ethanol use, we can have the mentality that rising tide lifts all boats, right. and we'll be able to increase our exports and increase our market share of exports of ethanol globally as well.
Right, very good. Well, a big thank you to Candice Wilson with the U.S. Grain Council. I'm Brityne Rucker, and this has been Ag AM in Kansas.